Good evening. My name is Mary Watson, and I'm the Executive Dean of the New School for Public Engagement, the academic division at the Milano School of International Affairs, Management, and Policy is housed. And on behalf of the school, the division, the university, it's my distinct pleasure to welcome you here tonight to this fantastic event, part of the series Public Policy in Action. So for those of you on live stream, I have some visuals here. Please join us, not only for this event on live stream, but also for the previous events that we've held. There have been three previous convenings, and our final event on April 27th. So we invite you to join us in all those events that have happened and the ones that are coming on. Tonight's lecture is one of the 2015 Henry Cohen Lecture Series, and the topic tonight is racial disparities and the criminal justice system. What have we learned? This is a very important topic, and a topic that has a lot of interesting analysis and debate and dialogue, and I'm looking forward to hearing what are the lessons, the key lessons we've learned from 30 years of research. One thing I do know is that there's a lot more to learn, and yet we already know a lot, and there are a lot of elements of this particular aspect of our society that we'd like to change. So I encourage you tonight to think not only about what we know and what we need to know, but what we're going to do and what we should do to actually address the things that are pretty clear to us already. This series has been funded quite generously by our donor, Susan Halpern, who's here in the audience tonight. As part of this series called Public Policy in Action, we've explored this semester the topics Framing Civil Rights for the 21st Century, the Changing Demographics and the Economic Imperative, Race, Higher Education, and Social Justice, Measuring and Influencing Public Opinion, and the New Civil Rights Agenda. This series has been actively engaging people from the community and from across the New School, as well as a class of students who are taking a class concurrent with this particular seminar series. And they get to meet the speakers and have a debate before the actual event. They're here with us tonight. And then we hear what we've learned from those particular individual meetings. Then we move to a public event. So I want to turn the microphone over in just a second to our own Derek Hamilton, faculty member who will be introducing our panelists tonight. But I want to also show us a recent report that Derek and his research team have produced called The Color of Wealth in Boston. This is just an example of the nationwide international research we're conducting on the issues of structural stratification and stratification economics, and looking at the issues facing inequality in America and around the world. Derek is a leading voice in this field, and we're very proud to have him as a member of our faculty, recently elected as president of the National Economic Association. So, Derek Hamilton.
Thank you, Mary. All right, so I have the great pleasure of being able to introduce the speakers for tonight, and I'm going to start in reverse order. So I'm going to start with my colleague and friend, Rachel Meltzer, who is a professor of urban policy at the Milano School of International Affairs, Management, and Urban Policy at the New School, and is also a research affiliate at the Furman Center for Real Estate and Urban Policy at NYU. That other school down the block. She's an expert on housing, economic development, and local public finance. She is currently engaged in projects that are very, very important for the topics of this class, which is examination of how and why retail and commercial services change in gentrifying neighborhoods, right? And I can go on and on about Rachel, but I'm gonna transition to our guest here, our esteemed guest, Monifa Bandele, is another great friend of mine. She is a senior campaign director at MomsRising.org. At MomsRising.org, she manages the food justice campaign, helping to successfully increase children's access to healthy food and working to stem junk food marketing. She has also worked with organizations such as the Brennan Center for Justice, People's Hurricane Relief Fund, the National Coalition of Black Civic Participation, and at the Brennan Center, one of the distinctions is, while she was there, she was the National Field Director for the Right to Vote campaign, and the coalition successfully changed laws in five states, including voter franchisement to more than 250,000 formerly incarcerated people. Also, she sits on the steering committee for Communities United for Police Reform, and she's an activist with the Malcolm X Grassroots Movement. For 15 years, the Malcolm X Grassroots Movement has recruited, trained, and developed cop watch patrols. I'm glad they're out there watching to keep me safe. Thank you. Helped launch two successful legal cases against police misconduct, conducted Know Your Rights workshops for thousands of community members, and worked to pass landmark police reform legislation in New York City. Indeed, several of our students have worked with the Malcolm X Grassroots Movement, and I would say the organization is committed to doing similar things that we at the New School are committed to. And then now I have I'm going to lastly introduce Sam Myers Jr. Gives me great pleasure to introduce him. He is the Roy Wilkins Professor of Human Relations and Social Justice and directs the Roy Wilkins Center for Human Relations and Social Justice. The organization's mission arises to merit such You know what? I should probably do away with this and just talk from the heart about Sam. I've known Sam for over 20 years. I met Sam when I was a graduate student at the University of North Carolina, and from that moment on, he's been a major influence in my life, but it's not about me. I can say that Sam has mentored and advised so many students who've gone on to have distinguished careers, and he has advised them in a field that is not often hostile to their development. I'd say that he single-handedly has probably had a hand in influencing over 80% of the new black economists who are now working to advance the scholarship in economics related to social justice and more inclusive societies. But I will go on and talk a little more about what he's done. He earned his bachelor's degree in economics from Morgan State University and a PhD in economics from Massachusetts Institute of Technology. And I was told over the weekend by one of his colleagues and co-authors and my dissertation advisor, Sandy Darity, that Sam has the distinction of being the first black graduate with a PhD at MIT. All right. He specializes in the impact of social policies on the poor. The breadth and depth of his scholarship is tremendous. He's a pioneer in the use of applied econometric techniques to examine racial disparities in crime, detect illegal discrimination in credit markets, assess the impacts of welfare on family stability, evaluate the effectiveness of government transfers in reducing poverty, determine the impact of food pricing on low-income communities, and detect disparities and discrimination in government procurement and contracting. Many of these areas overlap with programs and interests here at the New School. His scholarship has been extensively applied in practice. He is a national authority on methodology of conducting disparity studies, and he served as an expert witness in groundbreaking federal cases. And he often is the go-to person with regards to providing technical assistance to federal, state, and local organizations concerning the appropriate use of race-neutral or race-conscious theory goals. Indeed, he is a leader in theory and practice. Professor Myers is the past president of the Association of Public Policy and Management, APAM, the leading organization of policy analysis and also a past president of the National Economic Association, for which Mary mentioned I'm now the president-elect, which was founded in 1969 as the Caucus of Black Economists, and it's the leading organization in economics dedicated to promote the professional lives of minorities within the profession and producing and distributing knowledge of economic issues concerning African Americans, Latinos, and other people of color. One last thing I'll close with is this past January, Professor Myers received the National Economic Association's most prestigious award, the Samuel Z. Westerfield Award, which is the organization's highest honor, and it's only conferred when an individual's work with regards to the organization's mission arises to the level to merit such an award. So with that, I welcome Sam Myers to the stage.
Thank you very much, Doug, for that very kind introduction. Today I want to talk about 30 years of research on racial disparities and incarceration rates. As it turns out, several of my colleagues are in the audience who have been working for the past 30 years on this topic. And so a lot of people know something about what I'll be talking about today, but I'm going to try to give a slightly different twist, you know, on it, because when many of us began to work on the issue of racial disparities and incarceration rates were going up, crime rates were going up, arrest rates were going up. And it turns out that much of the body of literature has been informed during this period when crime rates were going up, incarceration rates were going up. And so how do you explain what's going on now? And so it's before we rush to try to conclude that we know the answers to what we need to do about racial disparities and incarceration in 2015, let's kind of go back to 1970 and see what was going on back then. So what I'd like to do is begin by providing some of the stylized facts about the incarceration rates for blacks and whites between 1970 and the present, and then a very quick catalog of explanations, and then some of the dire consequences associated with the racial disparities and incarceration rates. And then finally, I'd like to try to provoke the discussion and the dialogue that's going to occur thereafter about talking about the implications for the future. So there are some people in the audience who are just starting their careers. There are some people in the audience who are struggling to try to figure out, you know, what should I do about all of these major, you know, disparities? And I'm not going to give you the answer. I don't know the right answer to the question about what should you do. But I can give you some insights about things that haven't been done, that had they been done 30 years ago, we might not be facing the problems we're facing right now. So let's begin with some of the stylized facts about incarceration. So we know that the United States has the second highest. Well, it depends on which is the pool of countries that you include. The second highest. I mean, I used to live in China, and when I was living in China, one thing I discovered is that you can't believe any of the statistics in China. So is it possible the case that China's incarceration rates are higher than ours? Well, it turns out that you don't know what China's incarceration rates happen to be. But nonetheless, most of the newspapers, the media, recognizes the fact that we're up there, near the top, if not number one, number two, in the top five incarceration rates. In fact, black incarceration rates are 6 to 7 times higher than white incarceration rates. And that incarceration rates rose in the United States. You know, one of my former, Derek talks about my graduate students. One of my former graduate students is now the director of Bureau of Justice Statistics. He wrote his dissertation using the data from the Justice Department, and we'll be here all night if we want to talk about some of the difficulties of measuring incarceration, because some of the measures are measures of flows, and these are admissions to prison. Some of the measures are measures of stocks, and this is the number of people who are in prison on a particular day. And more recently, we've been putting people in prison who are not yet sentenced, so should I include in the count of those people who are incarcerated those who haven't been sentenced? It's a long story, but the numbers I'm going to present aren't affected by these little nuances in measurement. That we started off with about 199,000 people incarcerated in prisons in the 1970s, and then by 1.5 million. In 2010. And don't get upset. Somebody said it's supposed to be 3 million. Well, that 3 million includes people who are in jail. And so jails and prisons are different. But that sounds like a really big jump in the number of people incarcerated. It seems like there must be a business going on. It seems like it's almost an industry. Wow. Okay, so we all know that. And so. So I planned on my long list of vacation spots to go to is Seychelles Islands, and KLM and Air France had a sale last week. It was a one-day sale to go to Mauritius, which is only a two-hour flight from Seychelles Island. But now I kind of changed my mind when I found out the Seychelles Island beats the United States and its incarceration rate. So incarceration rates are, you know, around 707 per 100,000 in the United States. And in Russia, it's 471 per 100,000. What? Our incarceration rates are higher than Russian incarceration rates. Okay, so this is kind of part of the stylized facts that, you know, things are pretty bad in the sense that, number one, incarcerations are very high, but that actually incarceration rates have been kind of going up from the 1970s to the present. And something else that you probably have forgotten about is that 1974, when there were only 229,000 people were incarcerated, African Americans, who account for about 12% of the population, accounted for 47% of the incarcerated population. And then that number kind of fluctuated, you know, around 47, 45. And by 2010, it's gone down to 37.9%. But that's not to be considered good news, because Latinos are increasing share of those who are incarcerated. But it is also true that the total number of people incarcerated is kind of leveled out. And this is kind of the fact that is a wake-up call for people who are still stuck in the world where incarceration rates were going up and going up and going up. Because they haven't been going up. They've actually going down a little bit, or at least they have flattened. And so this graph right here seems to show that it's white numbers of incarcerated that's been going up. And black number of incarceration is always very high. It's kind of leveling off at around 700,000. 700,000 is a big number. But if you look in the context of why white people are so upset when public policymakers talk about black people who are incarcerated, just be aware of the fact that more and more white people are being incarcerated. And that might help explain why we have this kind of duality in American narrative about what's happening in Ferguson, you know, what's happening in Staten Island, what's happening, because white people say, wait a minute, I don't see this as a race problem. And the black people say, I see this as a race problem. Well, part of the reason that there's this disconnect between the way white people are seeing the problem and the way that black people are seeing the problem is that black people keep saying that blacks are more and more likely to be incarcerated. And white people say, well, what about us? We're more and more likely to be incarcerated too. And so one of the somewhat unusual consequences, which I'm going to get to in a moment, is that there's actually a narrowing in the incarceration rates between blacks and whites. But that's not because the number of blacks, the incarceration rates for blacks is going down, but rather it's because the incarceration rates for whites is going up. Now, if you want to solve a problem of racial disparities or racial inequalities, there are two ways to do it. I thought that what we wanted to do was we wanted to get black incarceration rates down. But what's happened over the past 20 or 30 years is that white incarceration rates have gone up with little fanfare, with little publicity, with little, I mean, how many CNN, you know, documentaries have you heard about the white incarceration rates going up? So it turns out that there are two ways to narrow the gap between blacks and whites. One way is to get the black rate down, and the other, the unintentional rate, is to get that white rate, you know, up. Okay, so what are some of the explanations for these racial disparities in incarceration rates? Well, they kind of fall into two broad categories. One category is a structural, you know, explanation. So the structural explanation includes things about labor markets, about schools, about housing. And the second set of explanations are behavioral, you know, explanations, things about drug use, drug sales, theft and larceny, thrill seeking, you know, anti-authoritarianism, you know, which, in other words, it's about you. So, people, my sister's a judge. She used to be a judge. And she said to me that everybody who has come before her is guilty of something. They might not be guilty of the thing that they were accused of, but they're guilty of something. And so if day in and day out you sit in criminal court, then you're going to see people who've engaged in certain types of behavior. I'm not denying the fact that those behaviors exist. I'm just suggesting that that's a different set of explanations for why there are racial disparities. And remember, I'm talking about not why incarceration rates have changed. I'm talking about racial disparities in incarceration rates. And so how do I understand these disparities? If it's just thrill-seeking, then you've got to make the case that black people are more likely to engage in thrill-seeking behaviors than white people are. I mean, the behavioral explanation places the onus of the disparity on the shoulders of the behaviors of and the actions and the backgrounds of black people themselves. If, on the other hand, you say there are structural explanations, then you need to look more explicitly at the institutions in which these behaviors occur. And so I talk about schools. Okay, so suspensions in schools, almost like the pathway to the criminal justice system. And so it's not surprising that the same people who get suspended from school are the people who subsequently get picked up for truancy, who subsequently get picked up for juvenile detention, who go to Boys Town, to go to the various juvenile facilities. And it's not surprising that once you get stuck in the juvenile facility, then by the time you become an adult, then you're in the adult facility. So where does it start? And so you can say it starts in your behavior, that's the behavior explanation, or you can say it starts in institutions, and one of those institutions happens to be schools, and schools have rules, and the rules that you're not supposed to throw a spitball at the teacher. It's just that not all teachers got spitballs thrown at them, and not all teachers know how to handle the situation of having somebody throwing a spitball. You know, something that's very small can escalate to a longer stream of things that ends up in these racial disparities and incarceration. So that's one, you know, kind of example, structural versus behavioral explanations. And so going more deeply into structural explanations, we'll talk about the Rooks and Kirchheimer model. And it turns out that, you know, Rooks and Kirchheimer taught at the New School in 1930, so at least this is kind of my homage to the New School. The argument is that prisons served as a labor market equilibrating device. That during times of superfluous labor, when there's a surplus of labor, that the prisons would drain off the unwanted workers in order to keep labor market stable, because you don't want to have a whole bunch of dissatisfied, unemployed workers roaming in the streets. But then, during times of labor shortages, then the prisons would open their gates in order to replenish the supply of workers in order to create equilibrium in labor markets. And some of the papers that Bill Sabo and I have written, and a paper that William Sabo and I have written, test this hypothesis. And I'm going to try to show the evidence in support of this particular hypothesis and to discuss some of the weaknesses in this hypothesis. Now, behavioral hypothesis, largely the result of work of people in the economics literature. So you have a group of criminologists, people like Al Bloomstein, they have their view of the world. But then you have a view of the world that is very much deeply rooted in conventional economic analysis. And the argument is that high unemployment rates produce incentives for people to engage in criminal activities. Once you engage in those criminal activities, you get arrested. Once you get arrested, then you get incarcerated. So where's the root? The root is in labor markets. The root is in the incentives and disincentives associated with participating in legitimate versus illegitimate activities. So can you see the difference here? The structural explanation is about the institutions. The behavioral explanation is about people's responses to those institutions, how they make choices. And it turns out that the behavior explanation does suggest a very specific set of policy remedies. And I'm going to propose a policy remedy that, in fact, was proposed 30 years ago that nobody seemed to be care about, but now we should probably rejuvenate this policy remedy. And so it's not a lot I can do about the structural explanation. I mean, you know, that you've got to kind of unleash 100 years, 200 years worth of prison devices in society. It takes a long, long time in order to be able to undo what has happened over 200 years within the prison industry. But there is something you can do in the short term in order to deal with people's behaviors. By the way, by making this distinction between behavioral explanations and structural explanations, I'm not trying to make the case it's one or the other. It's impossible, it's entirely possible for these two to be embedded in one another. Okay, so the test of the Hushin-Kirschheimer hypothesis is basically the test that there's a positive relationship between unemployment rates and incarceration rates. And this is the kind of like the scatter plot of the unemployment rates between 1948 and the incarceration rates between 1948 and 1990. And in this particular scatter plot, with the exception of the 90s, it's a positive slope. The problem with the 90s, 95, 94, 93, 92, the problem with the 90s is that associated with every level of moderately high unemployment rates was huge, huge levels of incarceration rates. Okay, you can plot it. You can run a line through it. You can estimate the slope in the line, and the slope is positive. The R squared is statistically significant, but it's only R squared or 0.1, or so, 0.1144. And so it's not the most convincing evidence. And in the paper that Sandra Darity and I wrote, we argued that there are a lot of other things going on, small things related to arrest rates. Blacks are getting arrested for trivial things. And those trivial things have big impacts on incarceration rates. Now, you may have said, well, aren't blacks more violent? Isn't that the reason why blacks are more likely to be incarcerated? But of course, in limited resources, what we want to do is we want to incarcerate the most violent individuals. And the answer is no, it doesn't seem to be the violent explanation. So wait, let's talk about drugs. Blacks are selling drugs, or blacks are using drugs. Maybe that's the explanation. And the answer is, unfortunately, despite the widespread belief that it's the drugs that is causing the racial gaps in incarceration, I'm not talking about the relationship between the level of incarceration and drugs. I'm talking about the racial gaps in drugs. It doesn't seem to be the explanation. So then you have explanations related to discrimination. Discrimination in traffic stops, discrimination in arrest, discrimination in bail settings, discrimination in prosecution, discrimination in sentencing. Let me tell you how difficult it is to make that case statistically. Because there's another set of explanations that's related to exactly the same observed outcomes. Offender decisions that result in higher traffic stops. Offender decisions that result in arrest. Offender decisions that result in the jumping of bail or guilty pleas or receiving longer sentences. So here's the dilemma. The dilemma is that I can't convince people to implement a policy designed to eradicate racial discrimination because the evidence seems to not to be as conclusive. You may say, well, what about Ferguson? What about Staten Island? That's not discrimination. And the answer is, you know, white people get shot too. The answer is, black police shoot black people too. And so it's a little more complicated. So I embrace the idea of saying, let's stop shooting our young men. I support that. But as a policy analyst, I'm also aware of the fact that making police officers wear cameras, or in Twin Cities, we required the police officers to give out their ID cards, their telephone numbers. While desirable, while valuable, particularly for improving community relations, might not reduce these racial disparities in incarceration rates. So let's look at the arrest rate issue. Okay, so the conventional wisdom is that, you know, the reason why blacks are overrepresented in incarceration, they're overrepresented because they are more likely to do the things which cause you to be incarcerated. So what you would expect is that the heightened incarceration rates must be attributable to heightened arrest rates. And arrest rates were going up until 1990. But then after 1990, white arrest rates were flat and black arrest rates have been falling. In fact, the arrest rates between blacks and whites have been narrowing, just the opposite of what you would have expected if the explanation for the racial gaps in incarceration rates was racial gaps in arrest rates. So it was kind of dispel that particular issue. And the other issue has to do with, well, let's look over the long term at the incarceration rate disparity and the arrest rate disparity. Well, the arrest rate disparity is 2 to 3 to 1. And the incarceration rate disparity is 6 to 7 to 1. Guess what? That disparity has remained constant, well, relatively constant, over the entire 30-year period. So that kind of dispels with the view that it's something about arrest that explains these differences in incarceration. Right, so let's now look at the issue of drug arrests. It's drugs! I just looked at the total arrest rates. It's drugs! So I ran a regression where the dependent variable is now to log of the incarceration rates by race, and then the independent variables was now to log of the arrest rates for drugs, along with controlling for place, time, for characteristics of a variety of independent controls. And what I found was that the elasticity of incarceration rates with respect to arrest rates, elasticity is the percentage change in the incarceration rates, the elasticity with respect to arrest rates for drugs was lower for blacks than it was for whites. A 1% increase in drug arrests produces a higher increase in the incarceration rates for whites than for blacks. So it's not drugs! I thought it was. I really did. That's why I read the regression. But that's, I wish that we had a nice, neat answer. Okay, so what are the consequences? So I began with talking about what are the causes? What are the various explanations? And I wish I could tell you I knew what the cause is. I know that it's popular to say that it's the behavior that blacks have engaged in. I know it's popular to say it's drugs. I know it's popular. And all these popular things don't seem to really pan out with respect to the data. But let's talk about consequences. Okay, this pans out. I know what the consequences are. So what are the biggest consequences? You can't vote! In Alabama, Arizona, Delaware, Florida, Iowa, Kentucky, Mississippi, Nevada, Tennessee, Virginia, Wyoming, you lose permanently your right to vote after failing. That's a consequence. That has a disparate impact on the enfranchisement of black people. We're talking about hundreds of thousands. You did not say there were 700,000 people incarcerated in 2013. That's 700,000 votes. Well, not 700,000. Some of them aren't in states that, you know, they're disenfranchised. So one of the things that we ought to be doing is getting rid of these felony disenfranchisement laws. I mean, even if I don't know what the cause of the incarceration rates are, I do know what you can do in order to address some of the consequences. Another consequence, there's a reduced supply of males. There's a reduced supply of marriageable males. This increases the share of families that are headed by females. This lowers the incomes of families with heads with convictions. This has an effect on your ability to save. It has an effect on your ability to get a mortgage. This has an effect on your ability to buy a home. If you have a home, then you have equity. You can use that equity and borrow on it in order to send your kids to college. I'm trying to say there's a consequence associated with this. I mean, you know, I don't want to get into this whole issue of should black women be marrying black men, okay? So fine, you know, go to China. There's a surplus of men in China. But to the extent that there might be a preference of black people to marry black people, then black men are not physically there consistently in order to provide the nurturing, caring support for the families that they're creating. Another consequence, you can't get a job. But I'm going to tell you, okay, let's talk about the normal kind of things. In Texas, you can't work with children. You can't work with elderly adults at home care. You can't be a locksmith. That makes sense, okay. But you can't be a barber. You know, I'm from Baltimore, and so some of my friends went to college. Some of my friends went to jail. So some of the ones who went to jail learned how to be barbers. You know why? Because they were cutting hair. But they also, some of them learned how to braid. Okay, they actually got a skill. But in Texas, they wouldn't be able to work as a barber, or a beautician for that matter. They can't braid hair because they can't get the license because they have a conviction. Okay, so that's Texas. Let's talk about Minnesota. You can't be a mortgage originator. You can't be an insurance agent. You can't work in a nursing home or home. You can't be an audiologist. You can't be a physical therapist. You know, all these people in prison, you know, lifting weights all day long. I mean, you know, it seems to me that they should be able to get a job as a physical therapist. But in Minnesota, they're banned. And of course, dentists, and of course, you don't want anybody with a conviction to be operating on your teeth. But a veterinarian, explain that to me. So what does it mean for the future? So there are two things I'd like to talk about. One thing I'd like to talk about, jobs. Jobs for returning ex-offenders. Something that I proposed that nobody wanted to listen to was subsidies to employers who hire ex-offenders. We give subsidies to people who are disabled. We give subsidies to people who are veterans. The purpose of the subsidy is to get people the experience that they've lost so that they can get that added boost in the labor market. We need to help reintegrate people who have been incarcerated. I mean, if you spent 10 years in prison, somebody, suppose that you went to prison when you're 20 and you came out when you're 30, 10 years of your life, you've lost 10 years of your community engagement. Okay, so what we need to spend a little more time reintegrating people, getting them involved. I mean, if you were an alcoholic, then you'd go through 12 steps. You'd have your support group. You'd have something. Well, what do we do for people who come back to our communities incarcerated? I mean, where are the institutions? Where are the structures? Okay, that's one set of explanations of things we need to do. And the second set of things we really need to think about, and I realize this is kind of controversial. Some of the people incarcerated got incarcerated for doing things that just so happened to be illegal. But on their face, like selling marijuana, okay, let's talk about selling marijuana. The only reason why selling marijuana
can result in incarceration is that marijuana is illegal.
Well, at least it's, I think it's illegal. Is it illegal in New York? Right now? Okay.
If it were not illegal, we'd be talking about these people as entrepreneurs. We'd be talking about these people as, you know, how brilliant this person is, you know, how good they are with numbers, how good they are with management, how good they are with marketing and advertising and so forth and so on. So let's try to think more about entrepreneurship. So if we can't get them jobs, then why don't we get them into businesses? Now, some of these businesses are businesses that require capital. They require loans. They require a little bit of bonding and insurance, and we should be concerned about the survival of these businesses. But some of these businesses, we're not talking about being an electrical engineer or being an aeronautical surveyor, but rather we're talking about things that, like plumbers and electricians and carpenters, things that those 10 years of being in prison won't distract you from getting the skills. But those types of occupations are occupations that are licensed. So we need to be concerned about the de facto bar of low-skill, medium-skill ex-offenders from participating in these occupations simply because there's a law that some congressman or representative said you can't be an electrician if you have these types of convictions. And so the bottom line is that we should be thinking about labor markets. We should be talking about eliminating restrictions on licensing so that when people who return to our communities after serving their time, that they can be productive members of the community. But also, it's an alternative to committing engaging in crime. And many young people would prefer to have a viable, steady stream of income as opposed to a kind of widely fluctuating, you know, level of income through illegal activities. And I mean, I'm not sure you buy this, but I'm convinced that this is an idea. 30 years ago, we were talking about this, and we got shouted down because the view was, why should we do anything for ex-offenders? We got shouted down because people were saying, you are in prison because of what you did. You have to pay the price. And I suggest that if the reason why you're in prison is somewhat more ambiguous, it's not related to your own behavioral deficits, then we in society should take responsibility to reintegrate the members of our own community back into the community. Thank you very much.
Good evening. Thank you so much for having me. My name is Monifa Bandele. I am a senior campaign director with MomsRising.org, and I'm on the steering committee for Communities United for Police Reform. And what I want to touch on this evening is the powerful intersection that community organizing can play in progressive research and policy reform. First, I'd like to touch on something that the previous speaker talked about, because I'm also a voting rights nerd. And back in the day when I worked at the Brennan Center on the Right to Vote campaign, like Derek mentioned, we worked on returning the franchise to formerly incarcerated people. So not just people who are in prison, but some people who are finished their sentences and finished their parole and probation in many states still are barred from voting. And that's a real travesty, and it's a loss in political power. But the thing that really drove me and something that I'm still working on is a thing called prison-based gerrymandering. And so in addition to this layer of having people lose their right to vote because of a felony conviction, communities that have high numbers of people who are incarcerated lose political representation because their political representation is transferred to communities where their loved ones are housed and not where they live. So for example, not to go too far in the weeds in this, in a place like New York State, up until the last census and redistricting of 2011, there were two upstate Senate districts that would not exist. They didn't have enough people living within those counties upstate who are actually voting people, wouldn't exist if it weren't for the fact that they could count the prisoners that were housed in those states. And so here, you have people have
extra political representation, right? So it's the voting residents plus the non-voting residents that the Senate district represents. And then where the people who are in prison come from, they have a decrease in representation. So their representatives are actually technically representing 300,000 people because the people return from prison, but really it's only 200,000. So there's the one man, one vote that's skewed by felon disenfranchisement. So I wanted to throw that on top of another reason why we should get rid of these laws that ban people from voting from felony convictions. So as a community organizer, I wanted to talk about this powerful impact of community organizing on your work and the necessity to incorporate community organizers and people from impacted communities at the ground level of research and at the ground level of policy development. Communities United for Police Reform is a coalition that a lot of people know about now around the Eric Garner case, the This Stops Today demonstrations, and the Community Safety Act that we passed back in 2013, which has established the Office of the Inspector General. But this coalition of hundreds of organizations was a long time in the making. And I wanted to start with a very brief story. Back in 1994, a young man named Anthony Baez was playing football up in the Bronx with his brother and his cousin. And this is a really, really a snapshot of broken windows 20 years ago. They were playing football, and this football hit a police car that was down the street from where they were playing in front of their homes. And Anthony went to get the ball, and he got into a verbal confrontation with a police officer named Francis Lavoti. And that verbal confrontation led to Francis Lavoti attempting to arrest Anthony Baez and actually choking him to death in pretty much the same exact way that Eric Garner was choked to death in Staten Island. And it prompted widespread protests all over the city. And the mother, Iris Baez, continued year after year after year to push not only to get Francis Lavoti brought to justice, but was able to link up with other communities, find out that Francis Lavoti had a history specifically of choking people when he was arresting them. And even though he didn't get incarcerated for choking and killing Anthony Baez, they were able to find other cases. Someone who didn't die from being choked by Francis Lavoti ended up having Francis Lavoti spend 7 years in prison. He's like a serial choker, right? And as these parents came together and built this coalition, Parents Against Police Brutality, their ranks began to grow. Just a few years after 1994 and 1999, you have Amadou Diallo shot 41 times. His mother joined the ranks of Parents Against Police Brutality. And a very important organizing model emerged between community organizers, researchers, and policymakers, which was that we have to really come together and design a new way of policing and to find a way that holds people accountable, but that is informed by impacted communities. So back in 1999, our organization played a role in a lawsuit called Daniels versus New York City. And we went and recruited a bunch of plaintiffs throughout the city who had been stopped and frisked by the NYPD for no apparent reason. Another friend of Derek's, Jabril Touré, who we work with in Malcolm X Grassroots Movement, recent graduate from Cornell, riding in a car with his classmates. They were all stopped, frisked. We got them, got a whole bunch of other people, put together a class action lawsuit with the Center for Constitutional Rights. And one of the big pieces that we realized that we didn't have is the data to show that stop and frisk had these racial impacts, that there's a racial disparity in who stopped and frisked. So even though the lawsuit was won, one of the things that we demanded coming out of that was a change in the UF 250 form, which is the form that police officers fill out when they stop someone. And we said we want the racial demographic data. We want race, we want gender, we want location. And because we were able to work with researchers and say, this is what happens on the street, like this is the interaction and this is the form and this is the point of data that we need, that was able to be a part of the remedies in that case. So fast forward 10 years later, out of the Daniels decision in 2001, we were able to have a body of data that showed who was being stopped, questioned, and frisked in New York City. And so we know now, in 2012, when we filed another lawsuit called Floyd versus New York City, that there were these huge disparities, and that tens of thousands of New Yorkers were being stopped year after year, and a very small percentage of them had done anything as far as having possession of drugs or weapons, and that overwhelmingly, upwards to 90 to 98% of them were African American and Latino males. So you basically had huge levels of racial profiling that we knew about anecdotally in 2001, but because organizers worked together with researchers and policymakers, now we had actual data. And we were able to show that in 2000 and in 2010 and 2011, at the height of stop and frisk, that, you know, basically any African American or Latino male in New York City had to have been stopped because the actual number was higher than the actual number that live here. So it was a very profound piece of data that came about through this collaboration. And one of the remedies coming out of the Floyd case now is that we're going to have a joint remedy process where communities and policymakers and the police sit down together. But I want to back up a little bit to 2012. And I hope that many of you know about the Community Safety Act, which was a big piece of legislation that the coalition pushed to establish an inspector general in New York City, and also to put stricter rules on racial profiling, to basically give the existing racial profiling legislation more teeth. That piece of legislation would not have passed if we didn't have embedded in our coalition community organizations and people impacted by the issue who could build the will on the ground so that every member of the city council had to take a side. Basically, stop and frisk was made, went from being a marginal issue to a central issue in the city council, and arguably a decided issue in the mayoral race that year coming, is that everyone had to take a position on stop and frisk. And that's because of the levels of community organizing that was happening on the ground. And when I talk about people impacted, I mean that you have to go to the margins, to the extreme margins. So when we're sitting at the table with the ACLU and Center for Constitutional Rights, we also have Picture the Homeless. We have organizations of people who are mentally ill. We have people representing South Asian communities and Muslim communities who are experiencing their own type of surveillance and racial profiling. And bringing those together is what was really important to build the will so that when the City Council passed the Community Safety Act and the mayor at the time, Bloomberg, vetoed the act, you had the first ever in history override of Mayor Bloomberg's veto was specifically for the Community Safety Act. And that's not because there were like, well, there were great city council people elected at that time, but it was really the will on the ground. The other reason why it's important to have community organizers at the ground level of legislation is that as policy advocates, you could design the most beautifully progressive piece of legislation, but if it doesn't have buy-in on the community level, meaning that I don't own that legislation when it impacts my community, then I'm not in place to hold the accountability to make sure that it's implemented on the ground. So it's both on the front end and the back end, it's very important to have this community engagement. Moving forward, every time, everywhere I go, it's always a call to action. You know, we have many steps to move forward. Just because we have the Inspector General in place who did a big report now on chokeholds, which has been a long time coming in New York City, and we have this new legislation for anti-profiling, there is always new layers that need to be passed and to be implemented. And so one of the things that I want all of you, hopefully, to join our coalition in working on is our next set of legislation, which is state bills. This coming state legislative session. One very important piece is a special prosecutor. Just 2 weeks ago, you had that same mother, Iris Baez, from 1994, standing next to the mother of Eric Garner, just killed last year, saying, we need a special prosecutor for police killings of civilians. 20 years of mothers who've lost their sons, and they were side by side by 20 other mothers. And so we really believe that there needs to be a point in an office that's separate from the local DAs who basically rely day in and day out on the investigation of the police departments for all of their other cases. and they also rely on the local police department to investigate the very case of the police officer in that particular incident. So there's a huge level of conflict of interest there. The second piece, which was mentioned earlier, is marijuana decriminalization. I hope that everyone is down with that. I mean, one of the things that we see, everyone's really down with that one. As far as some of the racial data on using and possessing marijuana, is that there's no statistical difference in marijuana usage between African-American, Latino, and white communities. But the arrest rates and the incarceration rates are hugely different, right? So that's something that we want to totally get rid of. And then the third piece of legislation on the state level that we hope that you're very interested in working on is another round of data. So we were able to capture that data back in 2011 because out of the Daniels case, we revised the UF 250 form to get this race and to get the race and gender demographics on there. But statewide, we don't have data for summons and violations, which is really important because we live under a campaign called Broken Windows. Does anybody know about Broken Windows? Have you heard about that? We hope we've kind of made that slogan popular because it's a hallmark of our current commissioner. It's basically the hyper-aggressive enforcement of very low-level violations. So it's riding your bike on the sidewalk. It's holding an open container of alcohol. It's just all kinds of disorderly conduct. Some of it you can't even discern what that is. And, you know, people plead guilty to it for some of the reasons talked about earlier. But we see anecdotally, just like we saw with stop and frisk, that the discretion of the police officer to ticket a ticketable offense and to arrest for or to arrest for a ticketable offense depends on who he's stopping. And that time and time again, black and brown New Yorkers are arrested for ticketable offenses, but we don't have the data. That type of data we need to collect on the state level. So there's a huge piece of legislation that we're trying to push that would revise the violations and summons data so that we would be able to look back and match up what we're seeing in our stories with actual hard numbers. So that's my call to action. I hope you have lots of questions about how you can get involved in this research and policy work and sitting down with organizers from every part of New York City, because we really believe that that's the only way we're gonna shift this narrative that we have, not only with police killings and brutality on the street, but also the high incarceration rates that we talked about for our previous speaker. Thank you so much.
Hi, everyone. Thank you to both of you for bringing up a lot of things, and I'm going to touch on probably like 0.00001% of what you talked about. So I'm going to try and kind of pull out, I guess there's like three things that came out of this, and some of it comes out of the reading that Derek forwarded to me that was a piece that Sam wrote, I guess, a few years ago. So I'll bring it back to that on kind of race and policy analysis. But so one of the things that comes out of this, which is, I think this comes directly out of what Monifa just talked about, is really the spatial impact of these disparities. And that's close to a lot of the work I do, is understanding that a lot of these people come from communities and come from, they're concentrated perhaps in certain communities, and then they go and return to these communities. So this question of reentry becomes important, because these policies not just, they don't just have an impact on these people, which is important, but they have an impact on these communities that they come back to. And what research shows, even in an incredibly diverse city like New York, is that there's concentrations of these disparities and these impacts. And so I think, and this is maybe an avenue for more research, we need to understand kind of how those impacts are spatially concentrated. And I think that can inform perhaps, you know, places of entry for intervention in some of these policies, right? If we see moments of opportunity in certain locations, moving from the ground up, perhaps from the top down, I think that's an important place to start. And related to some of the work I've been doing, as Derek mentioned, looking at investments in these communities, both from the public's end and the private end. And specifically, I've done a lot of work looking at businesses and when and why they decide to enter certain communities over others. And not surprising, there are disparities across communities, and those disparities are correlated with race in terms of access to some of these services, both public and private. And you see that a lot of these businesses are making decisions on information or really lack of information, right? Using kind of the information that's easily accessible to them that perhaps is not necessarily up to date or accurate with reflecting what's exactly happening on the ground. So what ends up happening is they're making decisions really based on prejudice often or expectations or things we think that the data should say but don't, as Sam kind of went through. So what I've learned from that is a lot of change I think can happen, and there's controversy over, you know, how lasting or kind of grand these changes can be, just in getting information out there, right? There's a deficit of knowledge out there, I think, about the viability of someone going through reentry of taking on a job, right, and being able to do that job effectively. I think there's just, you know, kind of bias or expectations about how someone might perform in that position. So I think there's a lot to be said of just getting information out there about, again, the charts that we just saw. I learned a lot from this presentation that I didn't know before, and I think that can do a lot of just getting information out there, whether it comes from kind of people doing research up here or from the community, right? Understanding what's happening on the ground, and I think that can make a difference in terms of not only what investment is going, you know, on in the community, but perhaps informing policies and how we can make changes just through, you know, encouraging the sharing of information, making certain information public. And so that relates, I think, to a lot of the examples that were given throughout this presentation of how data can be used, right, to push an issue forward to an agenda, to make a point, to rally the masses. And this is something, so I teach policy analysis here and I teach quantitative methods. Two very challenging courses, I think, in our curriculum here. And so when I'm teaching quantitative methods, it's a challenging course, and I get often a lot of pushback from students that question, you know, I'm not going to do this, right? I'm not going to go out and do statistical analysis. But I think today was a very excellent example of why numbers are important, right? And and being able to feel comfortable to present those numbers in a way that speaks to your audience. And I'm not saying this in a deceitful way that we're going to go up and manipulate numbers. People do that, right? But and you're going to be, you know, kind of skilled enough to hopefully discern that. But I think, you know, having the skills to collect data, to know what data you need to go out there and get, to know how to present that data in an accessible and convincing way can do a lot, right? I mean, we just heard stories about how that can make a difference. And I think that's part of, and this is where I'm coming back to the article, Sam, that you wrote about policy analysis and how we should be training kind of our next, right, generation of analysts, of policymakers, of leaders, change makers, that, you know, having these skills about how to read, understand, consume numbers, how to produce these numbers is effective, but also to incorporate this question of racial disparity in policy analysis, right, and how do we do that? And I took a lot out of your presentation today and the article that you wrote in JPAM about going through the research we've seen and trying to kind of understand and parse out, well, what do we know after we see all these years and years of research? And I think I would just bring it back to the beginning, right, as you as a decision maker, hopefully, right, in that place, and you're weighing options that to think about putting, now whether it's race, racial disparity, as, you know, as a criteria in that decision, and whether it's, right, the disparity in this one particular community, the disparity over time. I mean, this point about, do we just want to close the gap no matter how we do that? Do we want to deal with, are we going to wave our hands at the structural causes and say, okay, we can't really change that at this point, but let's help those on the other end of this, right, when we're coming into reentry. So knowing how to define the problem that we're trying to deal with, and then thinking about race, these disparities, as a real criterion in assessing the options and figuring out which one might, reach the objectives that we're setting up here. So, but again, thank you. I think you've given a lot of us, a lot of things for us to talk about. But I would just say I want to bring you to my classroom because I want people to understand, right, this is a very concrete, convincing example of where information sharing, just getting information out there, I think can make an important difference. So, thank you.
All right, so I'm going to break the panelists up in the remaining time that we have. It was meant to be sort of a round table with me moderating the discussion, but I think given the shortness of time and to get you all involved, I'm going to act as a discussion too because I can't be silent. And just after a couple of responses and then open it up to the audience to see if you have questions. If not, I'll proceed with additional questions. So I had three reactions from the presentation. One is perhaps more technical, and that is, of course, everybody else can respond, but the question of elasticity of drug use with regards to, I'm sorry, the elasticity of arrest for drugs with regards to drug use, I think part of the issue of why you get the higher you get whites having a higher elasticity than blacks is where you begin on the demand curve, on the, I guess in this case it's not a demand curve, on the drug arrest curve. Whites are starting at a much lower rate of drug arrest compared to blacks, so I think that might be explaining why the responsiveness for additional drug use might be high for them. The second thing I wanted to bring up is a clear theme that came about is data. Data and that might also explain our inability to demonstrate this disparate treatment in the criminal justice system. One might wonder, at least, why is it that we don't have better data with regards to crime statistics in certain areas? We've become very astute at using data and driving a lot of public decisions, and why is it that with regards to crime in this hotbedded issue, we don't have statistics? And Monifa demonstrated how her organization and was able to generate the statistics and able to move forward an agenda. And then the last point I want to make is policy itself might be endogenous. So that's another loaded technical term, endogenous. But policy doesn't happen just at random. We know that there's different policies depending on what jurisdiction you're looking at. We could take Ferguson, for example. Are the policies of Ferguson examples of what is generalizable? Maybe, maybe not. Or is it particular to certain types of communities? Is it the vulnerability of certain communities that allow certain types of policies to take to exist? And again, this might come back to data as well. And a last point I'd like to make is not all data is quantitative, that there's some qualitative evidence as well that is particularly useful when examining mechanisms. So, you know, let me let the panelists respond quickly, and then we'll open it up to questions.
I believe that the Department of Justice data that came out on Ferguson is not shocking. And I really think that Ferguson is America. I don't believe that Ferguson, Missouri, or New York's Stop and Frisk campaign is an anomaly. It's really indicative of the type of policing that we see all over the country. And as far as your question about policies and policies being different in different jurisdictions in different places, I think that's a really important piece. You know, we were talking earlier about people losing the right to vote based on a felony conviction. In some of those states that were listed, only certain types of felons lose their right to vote. And the design around who would lose their right to vote and who wouldn't was completely racially based. If you look back at the early versions of constitutions in places like Virginia and Mississippi, so things that they thought that African American men would do, you know, like certain types of vagrancy laws would lead to a felony, would lead to you losing your right to vote versus, you know, some other things. So we see that policies are very intentional. But how we work through policy reform, we try to sit and think of it as not intentional or benign, or that these impacts have kind of happened not through the intent of the policy. And it's very difficult to prove intent, but we can prove impact. And that's why when we talk about things, this is the last thing I want to say about the Department of Justice and their ability to prosecute cases. you know, they have to prove this intent, this willful intent to violate someone's civil rights. And as organizers, we really would like the bar for that to be lowered and to say that even just your negligence in the outcome being the same should be enough to prosecute you of violating someone's civil rights. So those, I think those types of nuances are important, that we can't get caught up in intent, but we should know that the intent around these policies existed, what the outcomes are of them.
So the reason why I'm glad that Monifa is on the panel is the fact that there are several illustrations where absence of data was redressed by community organizing. One illustration has to do with the HMDA data, the Home Mortgage Disclosure Act data. Prior to 1975.
Is his mic on?
Try this one.
Oh, just make it closer.
Prior to 1975, you couldn't test the hypothesis that there was discrimination in race, by race, in home mortgage loans, because race wasn't included in the loan application record. And the argument why it wasn't included was that, well, if there's racism, we don't want to stimulate it by asking the question about what race is, because we feel that if we put the race question on, it will cause racists to act on their racism. But the coalition of advocates for equal opportunity in housing said, we'll take that risk. What we need is we need the race question to be on the form. I'm from Minnesota. I live in Minnesota. I'm telling you, this is a hard argument to make. Because Minnesota, obviously, you know, there's no racism in Minnesota. And the people in Minnesota believe in egalitarianism. And they said, well, wait a minute, why do you want to ask race? If what you're trying to do is you're trying to get rid of racism, don't we want to have a colorblind world? And it turns out that you can't fight discrimination unless you have information about discrimination. Okay, so that's one example. And another, you know, example where race wasn't collected, and now it is collected, is an example of suspensions. I did analysis of test scores in Minnesota, and the suspension data wasn't broken down by race. The test score data was. We know how bad black kids were doing, but it was hard to test the hypothesis that one of the causal factors contributing to the poor performance is that the kids weren't there. If you get suspended and you miss the class where they do fractions, then the next day that they do percentages, then you're not going to know what they're talking about. So it really takes, and thank you, by the way, he's the guy who published my paper in his recent edition of the Review of Black Economy on the relationship between suspension and test scores. And so there's some illustrations that it really took some advocates to say, collect the data. Now let's talk about racial profiling. Let's talk about shootings. Let's talk about frisk and stops. The problem is that you really don't want to have 536 different methods of collecting from the 536 largest metropolitan areas and cities and places. You don't want to have 536 different methods of collecting data. Rather, you want to have something like the uniform crime reports. So the Justice Department tells local police departments, this is what we mean by burner. I understand that there are different, you know, state laws and so forth, but for the purposes of the uniform crime report, what is it called? Uniform crime reports. Where every person, every state, local government, every county submits its murder information, its robbery information, its larceny, arson, and so forth information in a uniform way. What we need to do next is we need to have kind of a uniform methodology for measuring the race of the offender, the race of the victim, and stops and frisks. In addition, we need to have a uniform way of collecting information on police shootings. Right now, the police shooting data is all over the place.
somebody at UCLA, I think, is collecting some information. Somebody at Washington University in St. Louis, or maybe at St. Louis University, and is collecting information on St. Louis County. But it's all different. What we need is one uniform method so that people can say, is New York doing a better job or a worse job than Ferguson?
So I think three comments. The first one is, Derek, about the point you made about the endogeneity of these policies. So I think that was a question that came up. So we're seeing this gap narrowing, and I wonder, right, is this happening in certain locations over others, right? Is this driven by certain locations? I don't know, and why. And have policies changed over this time period to... can you imagine, right? Target, make it now more likely that whites are getting incarcerated. I mean, is there something about like the policies over time that are driving these outcomes that we're seeing, and why? And was it intentional? Was it unintentional? But I think that's an important and interesting question to ask when we're looking at these numbers. And then again, I think great point, right? That data doesn't always have to be quantitative, and that's true. And in fact, we end up working not with often huge, large, panel data sets, but smaller kind of collections of data. And I would just put out there, I'm in the middle of it, so I don't know the end, but I'm reading a book called Just Mercy by Brian Stevenson. I don't know if people are familiar with that book. But it's a great example, actually, of not quantitative data at all. This is an in-depth case study, ethnography, of his work in Alabama, and it's just, it's heart-wrenching, but it's really, enlightening. I mean, you just to hear what's happening down there in terms of focusing more on the criminal justice system and what happens in the courts and kind of the rights that are there, not there for really blacks in the South. So I would just put that out there as an example again of where information and that's an example of a piece of work that is. This is not an academic work. I mean, he's an academic. I think he's at NYU, but it's published by, Harper. Right? I mean, this is one of the bestsellers in, the New York Times. I mean, it's out there. It's getting this kind of information out there, again, to go on that theme. And then the last point I would make, and again, I don't come from the area of criminal justice. That's not my area of expertise, but I do a lot of work on housing. And there's been a lot of lawsuits around housing, focusing, Monifa, on disparate impact, actually. And they've gotten to, the Atlantic Yards, actually, is an example of they got, there was a group of organizations and individuals that came together and, sued the developer, and they got out of that lawsuit more affordable housing based on this claim of disparate impact. So they did not, they could not prove intent, right? But they showed that basically, unless... they did a whole analysis, and there were a lot of numbers there, but they showed that unless we, you need to include X number of affordable housing units, otherwise it's going to have a disparate impact on, there was clearly on low-income individuals, but there was a racial impact too, I think, which they showed as well. So I think that's an interesting correlate to how they've used disparate impact to kind of further and see some actual tangible outcomes in the area of affordable housing.
So we are running out of time, but we're going to take maybe a couple of questions at once, and then give the panelists final responses, and then we'll stop. So I see three hands. I'll give the mic to. I got one, two, three, and that will close us. Was there another hand?
Yeah, there's one over there.
Oh, I'm sorry. Four questions. Okay.
Thank you. I was surprised to hear about the lack of clear correlation between the arrest rates and the incarceration rates, because I think, just given all that's come out in these cases recently with Stop and Frisk, the focus has been on arrest. So I just wanted to think further than that. I think about disparate impact a lot, and I was just curious if any of you had any observations about interactions with, for example, parole during the parole period, any geographic factors that contribute to recidivism, contribute to long-term incarceration, which might be affecting those rates.
Hold on until we get all the questions. Jot down your notes if you need to.
This is mainly for Sam, but I'd love to have everyone else come. So we've wrestled for decades, actually, with a couple issues that I think a lot of us, I think, would take to be generally true. that poverty is associated with more crime, and crime, and however imperfectly, ends up spilling over through arrest and criminal justice. But when we look at the data, right, we have you put some of the paradoxes of data, but we have trouble, in fact, in finding a good association between aggregate indicators of, say, unemployment or economic changes and their relationship. We're in the middle of a huge secular drop in crime rates in the United States, right, across the board, in ways that people, those of us who studied it for decades, don't really understand that well. So just some reflection on that. Yeah, we have this persistent gap issue. I don't expect you to solve that one, certainly not in 5 minutes, but this is something you've spent, you've been one of the leading scholars in this your whole career. What do you make out of that?
Sorry. Yes, my question was in reference to the, I guess, the incarceration of the gentleman in the middle, the rates that you gave. And I just wanted to get clear information on what you meant by your definition of marriageable males. And also, I wanted to know, when you talked about the incarceration rate for white males, did you put in there their educational, financial, like, familiar background, if that why it was higher than people of color? And also, when you was talking about the school part, we have to look at the way that our bodies are policed in school to begin with, and especially when you look at instructors in the school system, that black and non-minority students, we are looked at differently. We are also treated differently, even in the way that we are suspended. For instance, if a black young lady says something, she's defiant. But if a white young lady says something, she's bold. Or if a black young lady, she's wearing something, she's hypersexualized. But if a white young lady wears it, she's a trendsetter. So it depends on the demographic where we are when we look at this type of data and we start to analyze it, because the way I'm looking at it seems obscure to me.
Yes, having to do with prosecution, two different frameworks. If we went after high white collar criminals in finance, insurance, and real estate, and in natural resources, extraction, processing, and transportation, with the tremendous damage that we know they do and they continue to do. And at the other end, specific to Staten Island, the example of the drugs, Staten Island has a terrible situation with heroin addiction. It's concentrated in the southern part of the borough, which is overwhelmingly white, which is also the area of the highest concentration of families of uniformed people in the city. Police, firefighters, and sanitations, but obviously the one in question is police. And yet, if you enter the borough through Staten Island, through the ferry terminal in Staten Island, it'll say, get treatment. The rest of the public doesn't know about this. Certainly, heroin is a much more profound drug than marijuana will ever be, and it's being handled completely differently. So if those two very different kinds of things were exposed and handled differently, would it change the discussion and the way we bring justice to an injustice?
I'll do the one about, even though it's about your data, I think that, because I don't know how many people have been on a jury, had jury duty, I mean, or been on a grand jury. So I would say that the correlation between the arrests and the incarceration rate, that gap that we saw in the data that was presented, is made up for in the courts. I think there's a huge level of implicit, explicit bias that happens from the moment someone is arraigned all the way through the presentation of grand jury to the full trial and indictment. I was completely amazed at the indictments that were handed down when I sat for 2 weeks on a grand jury. You could basically come in there and was like, the person had on a red sweater. He's got on a red sweater. indictment, right? And when people who don't have means are indicted, they spend up to 1 year on Rikers Island. Like, pretrial detainees is through the roof. I mean, it almost doubles the prison population when you add it up in certain states. And so the effect that that has long term on like the rest of your housing, your employment, your schooling, all of that, ultimately feeds into a larger incarceration rate too, right? Because now, again, knocked to the margins and made to live off the margins. So I think the courts play a huge role. The police still play a huge role. I'm not backing off of stop and frisk and arrests and the desperate impact of having hyper-aggressive policing of low-level offenses in communities of color. I think that that does connect to lots of the outcomes. But what happens in the courts is equally as powerful and profound.
There are a lot of questions on the floor, but I'd like to try to address as many of them as I can. The first I need to address is the question about marriageable males. And that's a technical term, which is unmarried in the labor force or in school, not in prison, and of course in particular age group. And so this is just a technical term. And so there's no value judgment that's being added here. It's just a way to capture the supply of potential mates. The reason why I mentioned it is that there is a strong empirical relationship between that measure of marriageable mates and the fraction of black families that are headed by females. There doesn't seem to be a corresponding strong relationship between that measure and the fraction of white families that are headed by females. So it's just fact. I mean, it's just a statistical artifact. With respect to the issue or misunderstanding concerning white incarceration rates, I didn't mean to say that white incarceration rates were higher than black incarceration rates. Rather, I was attempting to demonstrate that the total number of whites who are incarcerated had converged to the total number of blacks who are incarcerated. But there are more whites than there are blacks. That means the ratio of the number of whites who are incarcerated to the number of whites in the population is considerably lower than the ratio of the number of blacks who are incarcerated as opposed to the number of blacks who are in the general population. With respect to prosecution and parole and probation, as Rick mentioned, I've spent my whole life looking at this. There's a little bit of gap in all of them. Every single step along the way. And I'm beginning to be convinced that there's no one smoking gun. It's more of a cumulative process. There's a little bit at the entry, there's a little bit at the bail, there's a little bit at the prosecution, there's a little bit at the entry, there's a little bit at the exit. So let's just talk about probation and parole. So people violate parole. It turns out that you don't really need to engage in a felony in order to have your parole revoked. Black people got their, black and Latinos got their parole revoked for administrative reasons at 3 to 4 times the rate that whites. When administrative reasons, like not being there, not showing up for your meeting with your parole officer. We're not talking about somebody getting arrested for murder or for rape. We're just talking about somebody who violated the rules of their parole. But you see, that little bit isn't enough in order to explain the overall disparity in incarceration rates. So I'm increasingly beginning to believe it's the cumulative effect of all these little things that seem to explode into one thing that we see. Okay, so the Rick's question. Okay, how do I interpret these declining incarceration rates? How do I interpret these declining arrest rates? How do I interpret declining crime rates? Okay, before I answer that question, I also want to talk about, I'm on board with this issue of fighting the broken windows model. But for reasons that might not be obvious, It turns out that the broken windows model works. Let me explain what I mean. The reason why the National Institute of Justice spent so much money supporting police departments engaged in this type of model, it works in this substantive way. Crime rates went down. Violent crime rates went down. Let me explain.
We call it, the surgery was a success, but the patient died.
So the point is that if it works in the sense that it reduces the number of crimes, it might reduce it by virtue of incapacitation effect. You know, indiscriminately just rounding up everybody in a particular neighborhood, regardless of whether or not they're criminals or non-criminals, it's likely to capture some of the criminals. Okay? I'm not a defender of it, but it works at a great cost. That's the point. The point is that somebody ought to force these police departments to do a cost-benefit analysis, because the cost is that it's $30,000, maybe a little more. For every one of those guys that we incarcerate, for the next 10 years, we're going to have to spend $30,000 or more. It's a reduction in the share of families that have heads, which reduces the amount of resources available in those families. That's cost. I'm not talking about whether or not the people are innocent or guilty. I'm just trying to say that there's a real substantive cost of that particular policy, and I don't see that as part of our national conversation of whether the policies that we are advocating that work, only in the sense that they reduce crime, are worth it, are worth the cost. So to answer Rick's question is that I'm struggling just like everybody else is struggling, but I have a hypothesis. My hypothesis is that there was a time in the 70s, which was the advent of the civil rights movement. Well, it was the period of the civil rights movement when we were putting in place race-conscious programs. There was an aggressive effort in order to recruit minorities as teachers, as parole officers, as people in the police departments. There was extraordinary sense of mission of curating racial diversity in different spheres of American life. And at the same time all that was happening was a concern about, are we going too fast, and can we use the prisons as a way to kind of put a damper on it? Do you remember we used to have riots in this town? Do you remember we used to have violence in that town? Did you realize that we almost had a revolution in this town? And prisons were actually an effective way to kind of curb things back. Because how many riots have we had recently? Okay, so prisons, I'm talking about the kind of riots where they were actually burning down. I mean, Ferguson, I mean, what did they burn down? I mean,
Quick stop.
It wasn't the same, okay. Well, we needed prisons in the 70s and the 80s in order to contain this very, very hostile and impatient subset of our society. They've been contained. We have gotten a normal now. The normal is, I don't really need to put a young black male into prison. I can get the same outcome of controlling these young people without spending all the money and putting them in prison. So my hypothesis is that part of the reason for the decline and the arrest and then incarcerations and then the overall expenditures is partly because of a ceiling that we've reached. There's a new norm, and that new norm, we have a black president. It was kind of the sense of, do we really and truly have to continue to build prisons in order to keep people in their place? So that's my hypothesis, and that's kind of a long-term agenda. For any graduate students here who want to be able to formalize this into a testable hypothesis, I'll be happy to work with you.
So I will never be allowed to moderate another panel because we're way over time, but I'm going to let Rachel get a comment in. If you can be quick, please, and then Monifa's going to get the last word.
Yeah, I just have one comment in response to Rick's question. I've done some work looking at the impact of crime on commercial property values, basically on trying to understand on the value of business activity, the investment of business from businesses and communities in New York City. And actually what's happened is overall crime has gone down, but in certain neighborhoods, I wouldn't say it went up, but it went down a lot less than others. So I think it still goes back to the story of there's a lot of spatial disparities, and there's variation spatially in how this is taking place. That overall we may see these big numbers, but and where that crime didn't go down as much are communities of color and lower income communities. So I mean, it's the that's in New York. I'm not saying that's happening all over, but I imagine there are similar stories, at least in other, you know, dense urban areas, that we're seeing, you know, return to cities, drops in crime, but it's not evenly distributed at all. So I think that's part of the story.
Last word.
Okay, I'm going to also, you're Rick, because they called you Rick. I don't know you, but I'm going to call you Rick. I'm going to respond to that question too. I'm going to give a hat tip to our movement and to the power of people in organizing and many, many levels of community initiatives that have been growing over the past few decades. And I'm gonna give us that hat tip by looking specifically at Stop and Frisk. Stop and Frisk stopped in New York City had a sharp decline in New York City because we threw everything at it, including the kitchen sink. We went at it with legislation. We went at it with litigation. We went at it with cop watch. We had patrols on the street, in the neighborhoods and the precincts where stops were the highest. And we made it very, very uncomfortable to randomly stop members of our community. So I think that what's happening from the offensive end is important to analyze, but what's happening on the defensive end is very profound. And I really call on all researchers to look at that piece and to do some data analysis on that piece, because the pushback from communities has been successful. And not only with Stop and Frisk, with community violence, there was an article in the New York Times on an organization called Man Up in East New York, who were able to outline a territory in East New York, which was like the hotbed of violence in New York City, and they've had zero gun violence for like a long stretch through using formerly incarcerated mentors, specifically in like a 10-block radius, right? And they want to scale that up. I wouldn't rely so much on, there is a shift in how communities are oppressed, but also communities are building power. And I want to make sure that that piece is not missed. And the second and last piece I want to talk about, a call for research and analysis done by Black feminists. Because there's a couple of things that were raised by both my colleagues, Sam and Derek.
Now you're not going to get the last word.
Around marriageable. About the roles of Black female-headed households, why there's huge numbers of Black female-headed households, how that plays out in incarceration rates, and also the economic impact and the marriageable impact of discrimination in the labor market. Everyone wasn't there earlier for Derek's paper. But I think that a lot of this research is looked at through a specific lens, and just like we need people of color to do this analysis and research on incarceration rates, on marriage, on family economic security, we also have to overlay that with a gender lens and recognize that there's a long history of Black feminism dating back pre-Reconstruction, and there are many factors that play into why Black women are married less often than white women. And that's in response to something you said before this thing even happened in your class. But I wanted to throw that out there because I know you all are researchers, and it's really a call to action to join CPR, but to also get at as many layers as possible and look at all the nuances, which I think that Sam did very eloquently, because I've learned a lot today, and now I just want to know more.
That's an excellent note to end on. Thank you.